Hello, Malty Mother Malters, and thank you to Chris in California for that malt mention. I am Ralfy. Welcome to a Ralfy review number 618, in which I'm going to review the oldest single malt that I've ever reviewed. It's called Glenburgie. It's a distillery up in the west side of Speyside. It's almost heading towards the Highland Line, in fact. And it is a contributory malt to blended whiskey such as Old Smuggler. It is extremely rare that you will see Glenburgie as an official bottling, and you don't find it popping up that much amongst the independent bottlers. And there's a very simple reason for this. It's a bit like Kippardonnach, another single malt that you've probably never heard of. It's not got such a lot of definitive, distinctive character. It's what some people would disparagingly call blend filler. However, the independent bottlers, bless them, and we do appreciate the fact they do this, buys some of these casks at various ages, keeps a hold of them, and then bottles them. And in this particular instance, you have a whiskey distilled in 1966. Now, I ask you, what were you doing in 1966, if anything? And bottled in 2012, making this 46 years old. Bottled at 43%, there are other versions of this bottling which are at a higher strength, but it doesn't necessarily make them better whiskies. When I bought this a couple of years ago, it was about £100. Expensive for a bottle of whiskey, but for a bottle of 46-year-old whiskey, it was incredibly affordable and manageable. And of course, me being me, I just bought a couple of bottles, one to drink and one to keep, because any whiskey now that says distilled 1966, or any 60s, even early 70s, is becoming increasingly rare. What I want to share with you is the nose and the taste of a 46-year-old malt. And then I want to expand in this and tell you really what you need to know about old whiskies, old tasting whiskies, what these tasting notes are, the form, the flavour, useful information, so that if you get extravagant, or perhaps you get really lucky, or perhaps you're just inquisitive and you've been saving up, as I have, to give you some idea of what you're going to potentially experience. I really can't afford bottles like this now, but I am in 2017 going to be buying some older bottles of single malt and reviewing them and sharing them, because as you probably noticed over the Christmas period and New Year period, November, December 2016, was that one single drop of water I popped in there? Yes, it was. Look, that's what a single drop of water looks like. One single drop of water. Oh, sorry. That's it, a single drop of water. There are some whiskies which only need and really can only take a single drop of water, if any at all. Particularly older whiskies, you've got to be so, so careful. But as I was saying, I got extra Google ad revenue, so I've boosted the whiskey fund, and I'm going to buy a few more expensive bottles of spirits from around the world, and really just share them with you so that you have more of a grasp and a recommendation and advice as to what to look for if you're going to be spending more money. Because there is this assumption that older is better, whatever the spirit is, that whatever you're buying will automatically simply have more of what it is. And really, this needs addressed. But first of all, you'll notice there's a glass already poured. I poured that glass half an hour ago, 30 minutes ago, and I'm putting a small drop, by the way, into the glass next to it, which of course I've just poured at this moment in time. So there's half an hour between them. Is there much of a difference? You better believe it. Old whiskies need patience and time and the right conditions to open up. I highly recommend that if you're going to be pouring a glass of really old and potentially more expensive whiskey, that you make sure you're in the mood for it and you season your palate with a standard accessible single malt like Glenfiddich 12-year-old. That's a good example. Do not season your palate with Laphroaig, Lagavulin, Octomore. You know what I'm talking about. Because when you go on to your old whiskey, you'll still taste that peatiness. Now, the nose has a beautiful raisin softness. It has a certain elegant fino sherry note. It is complex with suggestive, what we call suggestive tasting notes, polish, leather and tobacco, the three classic notes, particularly on show when you've got an ex-sherry matured, sherry matured single malt. There is an exquisite lime leaf and lemongrass thing going on. A little touch of condensed pineapple jam. So you have these kind of preserved fruit notes, yellow fruit notes and some green fruit notes. And again, you get back to this domination of the smell by polish, leather, old leather, saddlebag leather, as in leather in antique shops, leather, old furniture, a little bit of bookcases. You see, we don't go around smelling and tasting, well, we can smell bookcases, we don't go tasting them, do we? With experience, you become shameless about it, malt mates. You do. You start to kind of throw out some really, you know, obscure tasting notes that nobody would taste, but everybody has smelled but never really thought about it. So you may come across a bit weird, but don't worry about it. Just tell them Ralphie says it's okay. Taste-wise, tiny taste. A sweet and sour, sweet grain, sour sherry, sour wood, oak wood. The sourness is dominating out of the arrival through the development with some overbrewed tea, gunpowder tea, Darjeeling. It's a combination of different teas. There's some pickled ginger in there, a little bit of mint, spearmint, lime oil. And there's something else I can't quite put my finger on. I would call it an approximation. It's not exact, but linseed, liniment, hessian, fabric, damp wool. I'll leave it at that. Now, this has been sitting for half an hour. With old whiskies, it's a good idea to roll gently around the glass, hold up the glass. You're looking at the coat line that appears very, very slowly, where the moisture of the liquor makes, you know, ends and the dryness of the interior of the glass begins. And slowly it starts to thicken up, it condenses and it becomes more and more visible until large beads form, which drop slowly down the inside of the glass on what are called the legs. Now, if you are given an old whiskey, it's a very good idea to help you get focused on a particular experience that you're having by not rushing into it. You've primed your palate already with something else. You've not over-seasoned your palate with garlic or chilli, so you're ready to go. And you're just chilling out with it, because you're going to get so much more out of the experience when you take it really slowly. A good thick coat line. The coat line in this is almost 3 millimetres thick. It's quite, you can see the way it lies in the glass, that it is quite oily and viscous. And this is what happens with old whiskies. They tend to take on a mouthfeel of their own because of their prolonged interaction with the wood in the cask, where over time they're taking more of the wood oils out of the wood. And proteins are breaking down inside the liquor, and hopefully it's not been chill filtered. Importantly, you're getting the actual oils that came from the original barley distillate back in the 1960s, where the grain was a very different grain from the grain today. The yeast was a different yeast from the yeast today. The manufacturing process was much more manual. It was potentially more hit and miss, a little bit more haphazard, a little less rigorously controlled. But in fact, that's good, because I've talked just earlier upon the flavour side of it, that there was this obscure little note that I couldn't put my finger on. You know, the liniment, wool, damp wool. That could potentially be to do with the actual intrinsic flavour of the grain that was used back in the 1960s. Yep. It all adds up. Another wee taster. A luscious arrival. Then it becomes quite spice hot into the development. There is a little energising heat as you go into the development, which doesn't actually help, because it tends to mould in with that overbrewed tea note, that tannin richness, which, although rich and relatively soft, is masking the complexity of this whisky big time. It also foreshortens the development, and in the finish we have a tiny drop of old vanilla, old oak, overbrewed English breakfast tea, a little bit more of that old cask complexity, that dunnage note that you get from old warehouses, which are slightly damp and fusty. And then there you have it. So, for 46 years old, this whiskey, in my opinion, has been maturing for about 25 years and then just been kind of hanging around in the cask for a further 20, 21 years, just waiting to be discovered and waiting to be bottled. Any harm in that? No harm at all. But it is not proactively maturing over that prolonged length of time in the cask the way you should and would expect from a 50-year-old Macallan, a 50-year-old Glen Grant, a 40-year-old Springbank, or, heaven help us, a 60-year-old Glenlivet. There you go, just sharing. Here's the glass I poured when I started the video. It's not been around for very long. I've not even added any water. I'm not going to add any water to this. The nose is altogether brighter, sharper, but not with flavour, not with complexity in the nose. It just feels a little more youthful, but not in a good way. There's a slight solventy note to it, a slight spiritiness, which seems sort of tense. Again, this is, I'm just sharing, you get to a point with some whiskies where you've got to describe things beyond practical common sense and really just get a little bit more artistic about it. Hopefully my interpretation's coming across for you successfully. Younger, sharper, a little bit of custard in there, marzipan, much shorter, not this glass is that arrival, that development, and that finish. This glass, half an hour between them, is that arrival, that development, and that finish. It is same whiskey, but a tangibly different experience. I highly recommend, with expensive old whiskies, that you really take the time to make the time to engage with them on a more conscious level than you would with a standard whiskey, because you're going to get much more out of the experience. Malt marks, what am I going to give it? Well, I'm going to give this 86 out of 100. It's a malt mark. I can hear you already. I can hear what you're saying. Ralfy, surely at 46 years old, it's got to be 90 plus. No. I am not seduced by the messaging of flavour notes that include leather, tobacco, and old furniture, and polish. They are simply additional flavour notes to the spectrum of lemon and lime and vanilla and brown sugar and barley sugars and sherry and bourbon, vanilla, honey. All these feature in whiskies. With old whiskies, it's not enough that additional flavour notes feature. And important about old whiskies is the calibre of the presentation over time in the glass. And that is what's lacking here, which in my opinion, Gordon and MacPhail, the bottlers, have prudently, knowing that they've got a 46-year-old whiskey that tastes 46, but in fact has the form of a 15-year-old whiskey, have adjusted the price accordingly. Now, I notice Signatory do the same, and Cadenheads, to a certain extent. And I commend the independent bottlers for doing this. With official bottlers, there's absolutely no excuse with the price they're charging for seriously old whiskies with official bottlings. They really need to get it right. Anyway, moving on. Can you see this all right? Well, I move the stuff out of the way, but excuse me. There we go. Right, malt mates, pay attention. With old whiskies, here's the basic need to knows. It should be a big experience. When you nose and taste an old expensive whiskey, you should be immediately aware that it is more substantial, more long-lasting, and more voluminous in its experience than a young single malt, because you are paying not just for the age, but you're paying for the enhanced experience. The big experience comprises length and complex. The length of the arrival, development, and finish. It should be clearly longer, more complex, in that the arrival in particular should have more busyness, more activity in it. It should have character and personality. The development should be tangibly interesting in the different flavours which appear and perhaps disappear and then reappear again, because we're talking complexity over time. You do not pour an old whiskey and finish the glass in 10 minutes, because if you do, you're wasting your time, you're wasting your money, and people are going to laugh at you. They are, particularly if it's out of whiskey shows. You really need to take your time with old whiskies to experience the development and complexity, particularly of the flavour. You'll notice it on the nose to a certain extent, but particularly you will notice it on the flavour. The flavour development will happen not just over 5 or 10 minutes. It can happen over up to half an hour. You will notice with experience that certain whiskies, particularly vintage whiskies, that they tend to kind of fall apart, disintegrate. They behave, in fact, like old wines. If they're really kind of pre-50s, late 19th century, that sort of stuff, they can be terribly fragile. Literally, you can open the bottle, you can go back 2 weeks later and discover that it's actually dying off. It's dying in the bottle with even the limited time of oxidization. That can happen. It doesn't always happen, but it can happen. So you've really got to keep an eye on these old bottles and even put a little bit of argon gas in just to kind of keep and limit the speed of oxidization. When they start to go, that you cannot recover them. They are irrecoverable. That's the word I was trying to say first time round. So handle with care, store carefully, dark cupboard, cool spot, and importantly, a consistent temperature that does not fluctuate. If you have old whiskies in your collection and you're storing them up in your loft, you are making a big mistake if you plan to open them in the future. Big features of old whiskies, particularly sherry matured whiskies, as this one is, but applies to all old spirits really, but particularly whiskies. You'll notice leather in the taste and the smell, polish as well. Polish can be beeswax polish, mineral polish, pledge, which is brand polish, but you're really looking for some of the old fashioned polishes of yesteryear, and also old varnish. That's another thing to make note of. You know, when you've got a table at the window on a sunny day, the sun comes, it heats the table, you start to get a smell of the table and the varnish. That. Tobacco is another feature. I'm not talking about cigarette tobacco, although it's interesting to smell a cigarette before it's lit, before it becomes horrible. But pipe tobacco, cigar tobacco, old cigar boxes. So you've not just got tobacco, but you've got a range of tobacco that you start to pick out over time. And then finally, warehouse. Warehouse is an interesting one because wee story to conclude here. Big companies decided to modernise and innovate not so long ago. And they transferred some of their really old, precious whiskey casks out of old, slightly damp, fusty, dunnage warehouses into bright, modern, easy stacking, convenient racking, industrial scale warehouses. And then they discovered, after about 6 months, that their whiskies were deteriorating. Why? I'll tell you why. Because old dunnage warehouses give a stability and continuity of environment which contributes positively through its provenance and terroir through the casks into the liquor. I've been into a distillery warehouse which smelt terrible of rotten cheese, but that's because it'd been neglected. But you go into any old dunnage warehouse or a modern dunnage warehouse, modern as in Kilhoman, Benromach, or an old dunnage warehouse such as Springbank, even Bladnach too, because they're established modern stack dunnage warehouses. But you immediately be aware it's altogether positive and pleasant. You get a sense of ozone, of a certain freshness, and it's a lovely, very, very memorable smell. It's the reason why whiskey clubs, when they go to distillery, they always like to have the dram in the warehouse, if feasible. Because it's frankly, it's the best place in a warehouse to drink whiskey. So best place at a distillery to drink whiskey. Simples. Anyway, there we go. Here is my blackboard list of things to note when encountering old whiskies. It's fairly shorthand, it's fairly simple. I don't want to overcomplicate things because essentially it's not about what other people tell you to taste. It's what about you discover for yourself, and hopefully it's a positive experience for you. And I'm going to leave you with this. Beware of suggestibility. The whole wine scene has been racked, excuse the pun, yes, it has been racked in the 1990s, early aughties, 2000s, by a number of scandals as regards fakes and bottlings which do not live up to the hype. And this is a lot to do with suggestibility. When you get involved in a scene, whether it be wine or gin or whiskey, we all go along to whiskey tastings and descriptors are read out and we're in this environment and you're playing the game, establishing the consensus, and basically you're being subject to the manipulation of your interpretation of what you're tasting and smelling. Now, sometimes, to a small extent, that can be a good thing, but never ever lose control through susceptibility of the environment you're in. Never lose control over what you decide for yourself, what you are smelling and tasting from any whiskey at all, any spirit at all. Because when you lose that, you get sucked into a culture which gives you short change. Okie dokie, now you know. I'm Ralphie. I'm just sharing the journey. I'll be back again with Whiskey Review 619 before too long. Some weeks I'll do one review, some weeks I'll do two. That's what I'm going to do with the, in the blue jacket year. But I'm Ralphie. I hope you've enjoyed this whiskey review of this very old, 46 years. Oh my goodness, will we ever see the likes again? Of course we will, maltmates, of course we will, but an extremely higher price. Oh, extreme's not the word for it. Do you know the ultimate mission of the malt mission of the Scotch malt whiskey industry? Who's going to be the first to bring out the single cask, one cask of 100-year-old single malt on sale for £1 million a bottle? We can't be that far away now, maltmates.